Tandor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sugar Cookies and Sirens by Danielle Garrett, narrated by Amanda Ronconi. 1. Is it just me, or does it seem like it's always a holiday around here?
Welcome back to that full-time bakery life,
Jasmine replied with a smile. With a sigh, I dropped my bag of icing to the table and rolled my wrists in the air a few times in each direction. Somehow I'd wound up in the bakery's decorating department, a place I should never be. Trays of heart-shaped sugar cookies lay before me on the large marble-topped workbench. As I stretched my fingers and wrists, I frowned down at the front of my apron, which was starting to look like a Valentine's Day-themed Pollock painting, with splotches and smudges of red, pink, and white icing.
"And this is why I took the job at the Winterspell Gazette," I muttered.
"I look like I just murdered Cupid in the back alley." Jasmine laughed.
"How's your article coming, by the way? Did you get unstuck yet?"
My scowl deepened as I reached for a fresh bag of red icing. "It's a work in progress," I said, doing my best to keep a growl out of my voice. "I guess if all else fails, I can chronicle my efforts to get all of this food dye out of my clothes. That ought to make for some riveting content."
"I'm sorry," Jasmine replied with a snorted laugh. "I promise this is your last day on decorating duty for the foreseeable future."
I glanced up at her, the tip of my icing bag hovering over a naked cookie.
"Good, because after today, I don't even want to look at another heart cookie."
Jasmine smiled.
"Well, if you give it a couple of weeks, we'll be doing shamrocks. Then you can look like you murdered Kermit the Frog."
"I would never," I exclaimed, recoiling with feigned horror. We laughed together, and I squeezed gently on the bag to bring the frosting to the silver tip.
"Okay, now go away. You're keeping me from my next disaster piece."
"Yes, ma'am,"
Jasmine said, on the heels of another giggle. Frowning, I began slowly piping a red outline around the cookie. I swore under my breath as a thick glob formed, messing up my smooth line. My sister turned back.
"What is it?"
"Honestly, I hope you're selling all of mine at 50% off. Jasmine scoffed.
"Oh, come on, they're not that bad, Ella."
"Right." I quirked a brow as my sister leaned in for a closer inspection. Her lips twisted to one side, and a spark of concern flickered in her eyes, but she quickly pasted on a smile as she lifted her gaze.
"They're great. We'll just, put them in the back of the case and mix them in with the others. Once they're all in the boxes, no one will notice."
"Oh, yeah, a direct side-by-side comparison really ought to throw people off." I sighed and set my icing bag to the side. "Jazzy, please, send me literally anywhere else."
"Okay, okay, don't panic. How about this? Why don't we switch places? You can go meet with Cora Hearth and get the gift bags together, and then drop them off. The final list of deliveries is on my desk."
"Cora Hearth? Why does that name sound familiar?"
"She runs Wicked Wicks, that cute candle shop a few blocks down from here."
"Oh, right. She has that gray cat that sits in the window." Jasmine smiled.
"Leave it to you to remember someone solely by their animal companion."
I laughed. "Hey, what can I say? I usually end up liking the animal more than the person."
"And you wonder why we couldn't put your sunny disposition to work at the front counter," Jasmine teased,
though we both knew that was the last place I'd volunteer to be. Decorating might be painful, but customer service was pure torture. "I can handle the gift bags and deliveries," I said, pulling my apron off over my head. My long white hair was pulled back in a long ponytail, which was loosely tucked into a sheer hairnet.
"Great."
Jasmine turned to leave and narrowly missed bumping into our youngest sister, Candace.
"Ginger snaps, Candace. Where did you come from?"
Candace rolled her eyes.
Home? I'm working closing today."
"Oh, right."
Jasmine glanced at the cookies in front of me, then smiled.
"How would you feel about doing some decorating today? I think we have the front covered for now."
"Does that mean I'm off the hook for the deliveries?" I asked, already knowing the answer.
"Nice try," Jasmine said. "You'll do the gift baskets and deliveries. Candace will hold down this decorating station."
"And where are you going to be?"
Candace asked,
Off getting a mani-pedi ahead of your big V-Day date?
She waggled her thin brows at Jasmine and made a kissy face. Leave her alone, Candace, I chided, my tone coming out harsher than intended.
Sheesh, Elle, it was just a joke, lighten up.
Candace scoffed with a roll of her periwinkle eyes.
You're just bitter because your boyfriend would rather spend Valentine's Day snuggled up with a Kodiak bear instead of you.
Knock it off, both of you, Jasmine interjected. We don't have time for this right now. There's a line of customers out front. The gift bags aren't going to wrap themselves. And as for me, no, I won't be skipping off for a day spa, thank you very much. I have to call the credit card company because one of our machines is throwing an error code, and getting it up and running again would help clear the bottleneck.
Boring, Candace groaned. You should at least think about a brow wax before tomorrow. Just saying.
Jasmine's hand flew up to the tail end of her right brow.
Ella?
I cringed.
There may be a little on the fuzzy side of things. You aren't in full caterpillar territory yet, but...
Oh, good goddess! Jasmine's other hand came up and covered the other brow. I suppressed a smile. I don't think you need to worry about it that much, Jazz. For starters, you've seen Maddie pretty much every day since New Year's. He knows what you look like. And secondly, they're not that bad. A little pluck before your date and you'll be golden. Jasmine kept her hands over her brows, her expression awash with fresh panic.
I can't do this.
This? I asked.
This, all of this.
I looked at Candace, hoping for an interpretation. But instead of offering encouragement, the 20-year-old was staring at her phone with an amused smile.
Dating, Jasmine managed. I'm not put together enough. Most days I barely feel like I've got a handle on my own life. So how can I possibly expect to share it with someone else?
Jazz, their eyebrows. Please don't let esthetician Barbie over here spin you up. I shot Candace another glare. Candace lifted her gaze, giving me an oh-so-innocent look.
What? I'm helping her.
I threw my hands in the air.
Look,
Candace continued. She spun the phone around, revealing a series of text messages.
You're booked with my gal Quinn for 6 o'clock.
Jasmine lowered her hands.
Really?
Yep.
Candace pocketed the phone with the air of an Old West lawman holstering his pistols after a duel.
She can take care of the fuzz on your chin, too.
With that, our bubbly brunette flounced off to go punch in for her shift. I wasn't quite sure how long Wicked Wicks had been in business, but it was easy to see why the shop was so successful, even in the relatively small town of Winterspell. From the moment I walked through the front door, it was like being transported to somewhere far from the busy street outside its walls. A place full of wonder and inspiration. Then again, seeing as the proprietor was an illusions witch, that shouldn't have come as a surprise. Rows and shelves of candles were carefully decorated so as to appear full and well-stocked, but not cluttered or busy. Similarly, the fragrance in the air was subtle and not overpowering. I wasn't sure how it worked, but even while surrounded by hundreds, maybe thousands of candles, I didn't feel as though I'd been plunged into a bottle of perfume. At the front counter, a display candle burned, putting off the faint scent of hibiscus and something I could only describe as waterfall, despite that not really being a true scent of its own. Beside the display, a pair of ethereal blue eyes glowed as a gray-blue cat canted its head.
Oh, look, Cora. The town pariah has finally come to darken our doors, she said,
her mouth moving much like a human's. It was slightly unnerving, seeing as how the animals I normally communicated with all spoke in a quasi-telepathic manner. I blinked, unsure how to respond.
Celine!
A woman at the other end of the shop scurried into view, looking slightly frazzled, a knot of ribbon in her hands. She looked at me and offered a sympathetic smile.
I apologize for that. She hasn't had lunch yet, and when her blood sugar gets low, she turns even more surly than usual. How can I help you?
Yeah? And whose fault is that? I asked for my usual over an hour.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.